It's easier to take him down.
My name is General Fish.
Today we're looking at the usage of the tactical karambit. Now the reason it's tactical is because it's different to traditional. It's pretty simple. A lot of people look at the karambit in different flows and templates and different techniques and everything, but you haven't got time for that when someone's trying to basically kill you and you're at that level of being under threat, and that's when it's justifiable. If it's at that point, if what you're carrying as your EDC or your everyday carry happens to be a karambit, then you won't be doing anything fancy. You'll be more focused on getting it out into the game and making it a difference maker. So a lot of people ask me the difference between traditional versus tactical karambit, and it's this. A lot of people will, do test cuts. They'll get pieces of meat, cut the meat, wrap shirt, clothing, whatever around it, and cut it. But you'll see when they square up to it, they just go like straight boxing. Like this is just very basic, gross motor skill movements. Very generic movements is what I want to say. They don't sit there and flip it around and do all these tricky little things. You're not going to cut through anything doing that. It's for show, it's great, but it's only really good for martial arts demonstration. Well, my point is here is that if I have to get this out, the advantage that I have in this situation is that this knife is attached to me. You can see that there's a ring around my finger, and then I've got this point out here. So in terms of, as opposed to raw silat, for example, something else that I teach, the straight tactical approach to the use of the karambit. Here I've got a training karambit that's got a tip on it so I can practice my precision. Because at the end of the day, if this guy is wearing any sort of clothing like I am now, this hoodie, this jumper, right, it's not going to be easy to get through. So any of this type of slashing, with this very light sort of motion here, it's not going to do much. It's not going to have such a positive effect on the threat here. And what I want to do is incapacitate him or neutralize his attack against me and ultimately remove myself from the situation. I'm not going to sit there and have it out with him and see if he knows the same templates as me in martial arts or whatever. It's more about just making this the difference maker and surviving the situation. Again, you'd be under threat. And again, that's where it's justifiable if you make that decision that that's the case. So, looking at what I'd be doing here is having it from a position where he can't see, obviously. I might have taken it out or it might be mid-flight. I'm getting my ass kicked and I'm just like, bang! I hit him in the face with it. Do I know where it's going to get him? No. If he stands there and lets it happen, as in he stands there and this is a preemptive strike, then I might get it off. But when is that justifiable? Not very often. So, what I'm saying is your basic approach to this should be just like boxing. So what you want to do is you want to put your trainer in your hand, have it around your finger like so, and when you start boxing at the face like this, you've got to see what it's actually doing to your finger. Because this motion starts to rip out your finger. No joke. So the best option for me is to hit just like I would with a normal punch, like so. And when I do it, the added bonus of having a blade on the end of that fist just helps, like I said, the difference maker. So if I'm doing hammer fist, that's one way to slice him and to really get it up on him. But if I just know basic punches and that's all I've got, then fine. But you want to at least practice that and see the effects. Because if you see how I'm punching here, you'll see that the blade's actually pulling my hand that way. And that's not having a very good or desirable effect on my wrist. So that's something that needs to be brought to your attention. If you're grabbing them like this, even in the soft spots, under adrenaline rush, under the stress and the pressure of the situation, you are going to go into this full force. You are going to go in aggressively, and you're not going to be going like this and doing all these little movements and stuff like that. It looks cool, it looks great, it looks fine. But when someone's trying to kill you, put their hands on you in an aggressive manner, and you want to fucking do something about it, you're going to be reacting with assertiveness, aggressiveness, and intimidation. It's not going to be anything fancy, and sure as fuck won't be anything to do with fine motor skills or techniques. It'll be more on tactics. So, punching, when you look at punching, you've really got to line yourself up. And this is one of the best things you can do, is sit there and practice all your punching. I might put a jab in there to sting him or put his head where I want it. Boom, bang, like this. And when I punch him, you'll notice that I'm here with my whole fist and not just aiming for the blade. Whatever that blade gets, that's just added bonus. I know that I can break a man's jaw, a man's cheekbone, whatever else with my punch. On the end of it, if I get that, slice on his face and he starts to see himself bleed, he's going to freak out. And that happens a lot. I've seen it a lot. I've experienced a lot. And, this is how it works. So, if we're looking at close quarters grappling and having that the difference to make it, that's a completely different topic and subject altogether. My personal recommendation to anybody training this would be to do it the smart way. Okay, you don't have to fight so hard. You've got to fight smart. So, what I'm saying is, anything to do with this hammer fist type of motion where I smack him with this and then slice, smack him and then slice, as I said, smack him this way even and then slice would be a lot more efficient, as in minimum effort, maximum effect, and not having such a detrimental effect on my body. So the other thing you can look at here is if I'm to switch the grip, can I start punching like that? What sort of effect and what are the possibles and probables in this situation when I start, you know, doing this sort of thing here? So you've really got to look at it like that in terms of realisticness, reality, sorry. So I can put it in my reaction hand and have that aid him and tag him and start to freak him out, just slice a little fan and hit him with my strong hand. That might be a tactic that you wish to employ, but if you're going to train the karambit for, you know, everyday carry, self-protection sort of tool, you really got to look at it realistically. And this tool here, this training karambit for me is great because, you know, if I start punching a body-shaped figure like this with my real karambit, it's going to carve it up, it's going to fuck it, misses. You know, it can be up to $300. So, do I want to do it for 5 minute sessions? No. So what you do has got to be simple, effective, efficient, realistic, and cost effective as well. Because you don't want to be spending thousands wasting training equipment, wasting tools that you're going to carry for not getting the desired effect. You know, so again, just be safe, use common sense, and keep it broad.